My dear children, so let's continue with polarization we started in the last class. Today in the class we'll study four different methods of production of plane polarized light, and these four methods are: number one, by reflection; the second one is by refraction; the third one is by double refraction; and fourth one is by polaroid. And finally, children will know how to distinguish between completely plane polarized light, partially plane polarized light, and unpolarized light experimentally. So let's begin the day with production of plane polarized light by reflection. Well, you can see the diagram here. This is a transparent boundary. This is a refracting boundary. This is an incident beam of light, which is unpolarized light. And what is this? This is reflected light, and this reflected light is completely plane polarized light. Since this is a refracting boundary, therefore a part of the light is also refracted. This one is the refracted light, and this refracted light is partially plane polarized light. So what is happening here, children? Every refracting boundary, every transparent boundary is characterized by one and only one angle of incidence, which is called polarizing angle, which is called polarizing angle. So every refracting boundary is known by one and only one angle of incidence called polarizing angle. And when an unpolarized light falls over the boundary at polarizing angle, reflected ray is completely plane polarized light. So what do? We make the light fall over a transparent boundary at polarizing angle. And what else is very important here in the diagram? See, this is unpolarized light. The unpolarized light is shown by two perpendicular components of field vectors. One is parallel, other is what? Perpendicular. So this is unpolarized light or natural light, and see, this is reflected light. This reflected light is completely plane polarized light, and the plane of vibration of this light is what? Perpendicular. The component which is perpendicular to the plane of board is the component of electric field vector in completely plane polarized light, reflected light. So reflected light, which is completely plane polarized light, has perpendicular component of electric field vectors. Well, the refracted light has a little bit of perpendicular component, and whole of the parallel component is there in transmitted light. So this transmitted light is what? Partially plane polarized light. So what is difference between completely plane polarized and partially polarized light? Let us see that. If the light has both the components almost equal, well, the light is unpolarized light. If one component is completely missing, only one component is there, then the light is called what? Completely plane polarized light. But if in any light, along with one component, the other component is there, but that is very small as compared to both the components are there, but one component is much more greater than the other component. Other component is not zero. It is not zero. If that is zero, it becomes completely plane polarized light. If other component is present, it is very small, but it is there, then the light is called as partially plane polarized light. So refracted ray is partially plane polarized light. We have nothing to do with this. We are producing completely plane polarized light, and for that we have to make the light fall over the refracting boundary at polarizing angle. Well, how do we know that polarizing angle? That polarizing angle is known by Bewister's law. This is the name of the scientist who found out this, who stated this law and said that tangent of polarizing angle is absolute refractive index of the medium. If this is air, this is medium. The refractive index of the medium is same as the tangent of polarizing angle. So what is polarizing angle? Polarizing angle is going to be tan inverse refractive index of the medium. So children, let's apply Snell's law here. We have seen that when the light falls at an angle which is called polarizing angle, reflected light is completely plane polarized light. That's true. And that polarizing angle is founded by Bewister's law. And if we apply Snell's law here, this is angle of incidence I, this is angle of reflection, they have to be equal to each other. Yeah, angle of incidence is equal to angle of reflection. This is refracted light and this is angular refraction. This is angular refraction. According to Snell's law, sine of angular incidence to sine of angular refraction is refractive index of the medium with respect to air. So this is sine I upon sine R is equal to mu, the absolute refractive index of the medium. Now see, according to Bewister's law, tan IP is equal to mu, and according to Snell's law, sine I upon sine R is equal to mu. So from 1 and 2, what do we get? Sine IP is equal to tangent of IP is equal to sine IP upon sine R. Well, tan IP can be written as sine IP upon cos IP. This sine IP upon sine R is written as it is, and you can see that this sine IP cancels out. And once this sine IP cancels out, what do we get? Cos IP is equal to sine R. Cos of theta can be written as sine of 90 minus theta. So this cos IP is written as sine of 90 minus IP, and what is that? That is equal to what? Sine of R. So sine of these two angles are equal. That means these angles are equal to each other. 90 minus IP is equal to R. Well, 90 minus IP is equal to R means IP plus R is equal to 90. So what is happening at polarizing angle? IP plus R is equal to 90 degree. Sum of these two angles, this one and this one, is 90 degree. That means the remaining angle is also going to be 90 degree. Why? Because sum of all the angles over a straight line is 180. And out of these three angles which are formed along this normal, sum of these two angles is what? 90. Therefore, this angle has to be 90 degree. This simply means at polarizing angle, reflected ray is perpendicular to refracted ray. This is refracted ray. So we can also define polarizing angle as the angle of incidence for which the reflected ray and refracted ray are perpendicular to each other. Second method of production of plane polarized light is by refraction. Children, what happens when light is refracted across a boundary? When light is refracted across a boundary, more of the parallel component passes across than the perpendicular. Unpolarized light has both parallel as well as perpendicular components, and both the component represents what? Natural light or unpolarized light. And what happens when natural light is refracted? More of the parallel component passes across than the perpendicular. Therefore, what do? By successive refraction, we eliminate one of the two components completely. And what are we left with? We are finally left with light with only one component of field vector. And that's why we produce plane polarized light by refraction. This is the device which is used for the same is called piles of glass plates. That is a bundle of glass plate. We make a bundle of glass plate, and what happens? If this is your unpolarized light falling here, this is unpolarized light falling here, what will happen? This light is going to be reflected from here. A part is going to move in. Again, a part is going to be refracted and a part is going to move in. A part is going to be refracted and a part is going to move in. A part is going to be refracted, a part is going to what? Move in. A part is going to be refracted and a part is going to what? Move in. The part which is going to be refracted, would be coming out like this, and finally the ray emerges out like this. So what is happening? When the light falls here, the perpendicular component is reflected more than parallel component. So what happens? More of the parallel component passes across than the perpendicular component. Therefore, by successive refractions, what are we finally left with? We are finally left with the light with only one component, and that component is, parallel component. So parallel component is refracted more than perpendicular component. So by successive refractions, we get this light, which is what? CPPL, completely plane polarized light. Well, the third method is द प्रोडक्शन ऑफ प्लेन पोलराइज्ड लाइट बाई डबल डिफ्रैक्शन या डबल डिफ्रैक्शन. चिल्ड्रन, दिस डबल डिफ्रैक्शन इज ऑल्सो नोन एज बाई रिफ्रिंजेस, बाई रिफ्रिंजेंस, बी आई आर ई एफ आर आई एन जी एन सी, बाई रिफ्रिंजेंस. दिस इज अ स्पेशल फिनोमिनन एंड दिस स्पेशल फिनोमिनन वॉज डिस्कवर्ड बाई Erasmus Bartholinus. So Erasmus Bartholinus is the name of the scientist who devised this method, who discovered this method. And what he found out? He found out that there are certain crystals in our nature. There are certain crystals in our nature which show this phenomenon, which is birefringence. These crystals are what? These double diffracting crystals are what? Calcite, quartz, normaline, tourmaline, these are natural crystals. And this is artificial. Artificial means man-made. This is artificial, these are natural crystals. These are double diffracting crystals. And what is double diffraction? Well, when the light falls over these crystals, double diffracting crystals, instead of one diffracted ray, two refracted rays are produced. Normally, when light falls over any transparent boundary, what happens? Due to one incident ray, only one refracted ray is produced. But here what happens? If this happens to be an incident ray, instead of one refracted ray, there are two refracted rays produced. See, this is an incident ray. This is, say, the crystal. Instead of one refracted ray, there are two refracted rays produced. That is why the phenomenon is called as double diffraction. All these crystals show this property. When light falls over them, when unpolarized light falls over them, instead of one refracted ray, two refracted rays are produced. And these two refracted rays, one of them is called as O ray. One of them is called as O ray, the other one is called as E ray. O stands for ordinary refracted ray, and E stands for extraordinary refracted ray. Ordinary ray, follows Snell's law of refraction, whereas extraordinary ray is called so. Extraordinary refracted ray is called so simply because it doesn't follow Snell's law of refraction. But what is there? Both these rays are completely plane polarized. This is unpolarized light falling over the crystal. Well, one of them is what? O ray, and the other is what? E ray. So both the perpendicular components separate out in the form of two refracted rays. One is E ray, other is O ray. We want one completely polarized light form unpolarized light. We don't want to polarize light out of one incident unpolarized light. So what do? We resort to a technique. That technique is called as selective absorption is also called as dichotism. So what is this dichotism or selective absorption? What do? We cut and polish these crystals. We cut and polish these crystals such that one of the two refracted ray is completely absorbed within the crystal and other emerges out with little loss. What is dichotism? Well, we cut and polish these crystals such that one of the two refracted ray is completely absorbed within the crystal and other emerges out with little loss. This is what is called as selective absorption. Well, what is selective absorption? That has been shown here. This is symbolically shown here with the help of this diagram. This is an unpolarized light falling over a crystal, and as this light is passing through this crystal, what happens? See, the parallel component is diminishing, and it becomes what? Zero. And what do we get on the other side? The light with only one component, which is, say, perpendicular component. So that's how This is just the symbolic representation of selective absorption. So, what is selective absorption? Selective absorption is cutting and polishing of the crystals such that one of the two refractory ray, not necessarily parallel ray, is absorbed. Not necessarily parallel component. Any of the two component may be absorbed and the other emerges out with little loss. So that's how we produce completely plane polarized light using these crystals, which are called dichroic crystals. So the crystals so obtained, when we cut and polish the crystal such that one of the two refracted rays absorbed and other emerges out with little loss. So the crystals so obtained are called dichroic crystals. D-I-C-H-O-R-I-C, dichroic crystals. So using dichroic crystals, yes, by using dichroic crystals, we can produce plane polarized light. Yeah, this is the most convenient way of producing the plane polarized light. So children, final and fourth method of producing plane polarized light is polaroids. So polaroids, what are polaroids? Polaroids are most convenient way of producing plane polarized light. So what are these polaroids? Polaroids are made up of plastics. And what do? We take a sheet of plastic, transparent sheet, and right over this sheet we place dichroic crystals. These are dichroic crystals. The dichroic crystals are placed over a sheet of plastic, all with their polarizing directions parallel to each other. These are dichroic crystals placed over a plastic sheet. Dichroic crystals, you know, are the crystals which are used to produce completely plane polarized light. So we arrange these crystals over a sheet of plastic with their polarizing directions parallel to each other, and we fix these crystals to their places by another sheet of plastic placed over it. This is another sheet of plastic which is placed over it so that these crystals remain fixed to their places. So this way sheets of plastics are concerned, are created. They look like transparent sheet, but they are all what? Polaroid. Now why do we place these crystals here? Why can't we use the crystal directly to produce the plane polarized light? Well, the dichroic crystals which we obtain seldom grow to large sizes. It is not possible to make big crystals. When we try to make a big crystal, what happens? The crystal becomes unstable and it crumbles. So it is not possible to obtain the dichroic crystals of big sizes. So what do? We make very fine, wafer thin crystals. And these crystals are arranged over a sheet of plastics and they are fixed to their places. We laminate them over this plastic sheet. In between two plastic sheets, we fix these crystals. And this way, the plastic sheets which are obtained are called polaroids. Children, let us now distinguish unpolarized light, completely plane polarized light and partially plane polarized light from each other. And how do we distinguish this experimentally? So for distinguishing these lights from each other experimentally, we let the light pass through a rotating polaroid. How do we let the light pass through a rotating polaroid? Well, suppose you are asked to identify the nature of light in the adjacent room. So what you are supposed to do, you look into the room with polaroid sheet in front of your eyes. And when you look through the polaroid, you would be able to see everything inside the room. There would be some variation of intensity and you would be able to look into the room. And while looking through the polaroid into the room, you rotate the polaroid. So what happens? The light from the room is passing through the rotating polaroid. Now you have to observe what is happening. So look through the polaroid and rotate the sheet of polaroid. That way the light passes through rotating polaroid. Light of the room passes through rotating polaroid. Now if you see the if you find that there is no variation of intensity at all inside the room, you find that the intensity remains same. There is no variation of intensity even if you are rotating the polar sheet. That simply means that light inside the room is what? Unpolarized light. If there is no variation of intensity, then the light present is unpolarized light. And if there is variation of intensity, if the intensity of the light inside the room varies as you rotate the polaroid, well, you have to look at the variation. If the intensity varies between maxima and minima, so look at this minimum intensity. If this minimum intensity is zero, that means for certain position of polaroid sheet in front of your eye, there is perfect darkness inside the room. So when you see no light inside the room for certain position of the polaroid, that means minimum intensity is zero. If minimum intensity is zero, this simply means the light present inside the room is what? Completely plain polarized light. And if the variation takes place between maximum and minimum, and minimum intensity is dim light, but it is not zero. You rotate the polaroid for certain position of polaroid, you see that there is very little light inside the room. If that be the case, minimum is not equal to zero, it is dim light. Well, the light present inside the room is partially plain polarized light. Children, finally, let us look at the uses of polaroids. Polaroids are used in sunglasses to cut off the glare. Polaroids are used by the students in physics lab for experimentation. And of course, they produce what? Completely plain polarized light using polaroid sheets. Polaroids are used in window panes of what? Cars, AC coaches, AC trains, aeroplanes. So they are also used as window panes. They are used in 3D moving. Yeah, in making 3D movie, we use polaroid sheets. And they are also used in calculator. You know, in calculator, there is liquid crystal display. And how these digits are displayed? These digits are displayed using the principle of polarization. Besides this, there are multiple uses of polaroids. So children, with this, we come to the end of the chapter polarization. This is all from my side. God bless you all.